Well, I saved the hottest for last as we've considered the doctrine of angels and the doctrines of demons and Satan. And we've looked at, for 2 weeks, we spent talking about heaven, a theology of heaven. And this week we are going to be talking, as you've heard us say a couple of times, about the biblical doctrine of hell. And the reason why we do this is because we know, like these other topics, it is very poorly understood. The question that is often asked from those who struggle with this doctrine is, what grounds does God have to punish someone for eternity? What justification is there for a holy and perfect God to forgive a wicked and rebellious sinner? What justification is there for a holy and perfect God to forgive a wicked and rebellious sinner? In other words, what grounds does God have to forgive the most vile and wretched of people? What justification is there for a holy and perfect God to forgive a wicked and rebellious sinner? What justification is there for a holy and perfect God to forgive a wicked and rebellious sinner? In other words, what grounds does God have to forgive the most vile and wretched of people? What justification is there for a holy and perfect God to forgive a wicked and rebellious sinner? What justification is there for a holy and perfect God to forgive a wicked and rebellious sinner? In other words, what grounds does God have to forgive the most vile and wretched of people? What justification is there for a holy and perfect God to forgive a wicked and rebellious sinner? What justification
salvation and peace with God is by looking to Christ, by seeing His perfection, by knowing that He is righteous. I'm wicked and sinful, and I need Christ as my Savior. When I begin to understand that, I begin to take on a biblical worldview. And it made grace amazing and beautiful and glorious, and it made me thankful. I believe that one of the main reasons why Christians suffer from ingratitude and a lack of thankfulness is because they do not really understand the depravity of their own sin.